They say hardware is hard, and they are absolutely right. But I would add this: innovation is an ungrateful. Let me explain. In 2021, we set out to build our vision of the best ergonomic keyboard. Columnar layout, comfortable thumb keys, foldable tenting up to 60 degrees, a premium aluminum body, plush magnetic pad pads, and the cherry on top, three-way connectivity with low latency RF, multi-device Bluetooth, and USB. Something no split keyboard had ever done. It was ambitious, maybe too ambitious, because every one of those things came back to bite us. Part 1. The hardware challenges. We spent months researching and prototyping to design a layout and thumb cluster that would fit as many hand sizes as possible. We even made a video about the process, if you're curious. The foldable 60-degree tenting was another huge challenge. Tenting solutions were usually bulky, ugly, and difficult to use, and they added too much height. After countless iterations, we finally found an elegant, sturdy design that could fold into the body of the keyboard when you didn't want it. Then came the aluminum top panel and the plush magnetic pad pads. Mixing materials, manufacturing techniques, and tolerances while aiming for a premium finish? That was tough. All these meant delays. Many delays. We announced the keyboard in 2022, hoping to ship by the end of the year. But it took over a year to refine the design for mass production. This is where hardware becomes hard. By summer 2023, we finally shipped the first keyboards and immediately ran into more problems. This is where we discovered the dark side of innovation. The travel case didn't hold the keyboard properly during shipping. Some cables didn't connect correctly to the neuron. And let's not forget about the low-profile thumb keys, too brittle and prone to breaking. We scrambled to fix everything. We added a custom-cut foam to the case, adjusted the cables, redesigned the neuron case, and switched from ABS to polycarbonate for the keycaps. But by then, many keyboards were already in people's hands, so we had to recall them or send parts to those affected. Looking back, it doesn't seem so terrible, but at the time, those first bug reports felt like a punch to the gut. We thought we had learned our lesson. Innovation is an ungrateful but the worst was still ahead. Part 2. The connectivity challenges. Remember that three-way connectivity with RF, Bluetooth, and USB? There is a reason no other split keyboard had it. Making it flawless is a titanic endeavor. And just like the Titanic, we almost sunk with it. Five different chips need to talk to each other to send one key press, and they didn't always play nice. We faced everything. Higher latency than expected, multiple all-ROS key presses, wrong battery readings, short battery life, random disconnections, and Bluetooth limitations. Over the following months, we tackled the critical stuff. We added support for up to 5 Bluetooth devices, we slashed latency, we introduced sleep mode for longer battery life, and we eliminated lost or repeated key presses. However, the inconsistencies remained. Sometimes the keyboard switched to Bluetooth while wired, others, it briefly disconnected and reconnected. Or it wouldn't work on boot without turning it off and on again. It just didn't feel solid. Do you know how long it took to fix that? A year. And 23 betas. 23. Just to get it right. Why, you wonder? Because we had to rewrite how the chips talk to each other. From scratch. Before, they just yelled at each other, like rude people at a party. Now they politely ask each other before sending a message. And then invite each other to tea at 5.
Morning, darling. Tea?
Of course, that opened a whole new can of worms. Hence the 23 betas and months of testing. The good thing, now the keyboard feels snappier, consistent, reliable.
I never doubted you.
Part 3. The work continues. And that brings us to today. We've just released the Defy 2.1.1 and the Raise 2 1.3.2 firmware. This update fixes a rare bug where one side of the keyboard sometimes didn't wake from true sleep. You'll find this update under the firmware menu in Basecore. But that's not all. We also have new beta firmware, the Defy 2.2 and the Raise 2 1.4. You can try them at dygma.com/defybeta and dygma.com/raise2beta. This firmware update brings a better battery reading algorithm and a completely new low battery behavior. Before, the lights started to dim at 20% battery. This confused people and sometimes caused flickering. Now, the lights stay on and you'll see the low battery warning animation at 10%. But wait, there's even more! We have new Superkeys! Part 4. The new Superkeys. For those of you who don't know, Superkeys let you bind different actions to one key depending on how you press it. Tap, hold, tap and hold, double tap, and double tap and hold. Sounds amazing, right? Well, here's the catch. Timing.
Do you know what's a good point of a good yoke? Timing.
How long should you hold the key before it counts as hold? And if you tap the key twice, does that mean two taps or one double tap? We solved some of these issues early on. We gave you settings to fine-tune those timings. And we added fast superkeys. So if you only use tap and hold, it won't wait for a double tap. But the hardest problem remains, when to trigger tap and when to trigger hold. Right now, it's based on a single setting, hold timeout. That means hold won't trigger until that time has passed. But what if you need hold faster, like when you press shift and a letter to capitalize it? One option was to make the hold trigger when you pressed another key after pressing the super key. But there's a problem. When we type, we tend to roll our keys. We press the next key before fully releasing the previous one. That caused unwanted holds. And you really don't want to trigger Ctrl Q when you mean just Q. So we added a minimum hold time. Hold won't trigger unless that minimum time has elapsed, even if you press another key. That way you can roll your keys without trouble. Clever, right? Well, not clever enough. If you set the minimum too high, hold won't trigger when needed. Set it too low and it triggers accidentally. And this is how it works on the new beta, using the minimum hold time of the add a key on tap. Here's the breakthrough though. When we type normally, we roll our keys much faster than when we want to trigger a hold, like when using a modifier. That means that we release the super key faster than when we want a hold. So now we're building a system that measures that release speed. Release quickly, and it's a tap. Hold a bit longer, then it's a hold. And of course, you'll be able to tweak it. That's the dark side of innovation. You start with what you believe is a great idea. You naively throw it out there, and people seem to love it. Then the hype fades, and you're left wrestling with the harsh reality. But when it finally works, it's worth every late night, every bug report, every tear shed. Enjoy the new feature.
¡Qué final más épico!